But if you look at that shellcode, you will see there are zeros within that shellcode. That's not too cool, because actually we're dealing with strings, and strings, they're just zero terminated. That means, well, we shouldn't have zeros within that shellcode. So we will have to do some optimization, which I'm afraid I can't too much explain. I mean, this is the optimized shellcode, and you can see those values with zeros, they were replaced with some code that doesn't contain zeros. And if you just assemble it, no, we don't need it static. We just need it shell. Whoa. What's going on here? Oh, well, I think I have to explain it, because... No, I can't explain it. There's no time to explain it. We just need the shellcode anyway. We can't execute the shellcode right from the shell. Let's just look at the object dump. So, there it is. This is our code. You can see the jump, and to the end, you have the call to the begin. And this is actually the shell code that we need. These are the bytes that our shell code will consist of. And what I'm doing now is just put all this together into a shell code test. This is our shell code, just in hexadecimal notation, and I just wrote what's going on in there. It's actually the representation of the bytes as seen by the processor. So that's the value that's in the data, and that's what the processor makes of it. And this just calls the shell code. So this will just do it. I have to compile it. That's our shellcode. That's what it does. So let's put all this together. We've got a vulnerable program going on. Where is it? Vulnerable.c. That's a pretty stupid program. I just look at it. Well, what it does, it opens a file, TMP input, and it reads that input in a very large buffer of 1024 bytes, and it just does something with that buffer and writes something to a file. That's really very simple. And this do something, well, there's a smaller buffer, and the whole string that was contained in the input file will be just written into the buffer. And, well, what you can see is if the buffer here is very much longer and the string inside it, it would just make a buffer overflow right here. And there's nothing going on here except stripping the following returns from that string and just printing some debug information. So that's our vulnerable program. Well, and to just take advantage of all that, we will have to make this a root program. So what we have here is an unprivileged user. Okay. And we will just put some data into that input file and just execute a vulnerable program. So what it did, it was it wrote all that into its log. It was called daemon log. So there it is. The message was hello. Well, it will do that very much as often as we want. And it will log that information that we gave to it into that file. So, but as this program is just running as a root, and no, actually it's not yet. So now it is. It has the setuid root bit. And it will execute with root functions, privileges. So let's just put an exploit together. So here's our shell code. And what's going on here in the routine is this thing will take three arguments. This is a value called nopfill, the return address, and the return fill. And this one just puts the nops into the output. It's just the character 90. That's the instruction nop. And at the next, the shell code will be written to the output. It's like that one here. And in the end, we're going to append some return addresses that will just go over the control data. And oh, great, I've already got it here. We just knew our buffer would be about 512 bytes, so let's put 400 nops in there. And in the end, we will have an idea about where the buffer lies. That was like BFFF. It should be somewhere around here. I mean, we could go through the GDB and just look where actually the buffer lives. But we have got 400 nops to meet, so we can just have a good guess right here. And let's append some 30 return addresses in the end. So that went to standard output. It doesn't look very cool. Let's put it into that file that our vulnerable program is going to execute to process. It was TMP input. See, we are still unprivileged user. And just let's give it a shot right here. This is our packet that we made. It's a lot of nops, then there's a shellcode, and a lot of return addresses. And that's going to overwrite the stack frame just right here. So our vulnerable program is going to process the input file, and the buffer will be overwritten. That's not so good. Let's try some other addresses right here. Damn. Let's try some more. Let's try for 40. See what's going on there. So we had just some debug info output. So this was the address of the buffer. I just had it printed here. And let's just try some address in that space. So you see, this pointed just before our buffer, so that really can't work. Let's just try something above that for 70 or something like that. Whoa, there's our shell code. And now we've got root privileges. Thanks. And we just instructed the program to do things it just wasn't really meant to do. And that's pretty bad. Damn. So what can we do against all this? I mean, just learn how to program. That's the best thing to do. I mean, don't use string copy. That's the first thing you can tell everybody. I mean, just use the counterpart that will be limited to a number. That they're called string and copy and string and cat and string and up. And they're just great. You can just give a maximum size for the buffer and everything is great. Do proper user input sanitation. I mean, don't trust user input. Just be very specific with it. I mean, just look very close at it. I mean, there are people who are trying to overflow your buffers. And you can do proper testing of your code. I mean, fuzzing is, well, you can learn more about this on, tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, there's a course about fuzzing, what's going on there. And you can use some stack randomization patches like PAX or execshield. And actually, I just learned the Linux kernel from 2.6.12 on has built-in randomization. And I will just show you how that works. And in the end, you can look at the non-executable bit. You can just make the whole stack where the shellcode is not executable. But there are ways around it because it's very badly implemented in the processors. So just one thing to the end. You will see that buffer overflow here works. It's just great. And if we just turn on the stack randomization in the Linux kernel, it's through the proc interface in that variable here. Now it's turned on. And you will see the overflow doesn't work anymore. I mean, the program crashes very badly, but the return address is not right. It's just because the stack pointer is now variable. It changes its value from call to call. So the memory layout is not the same for every process that we execute. And, well, that doesn't look very good. And so the chance to find the right address when we are trying to overflow the buffer, they are very limited. So just use a proper kernel and you will be quite safe from that. Well, okay, that's it. I mean, you know, there was a problem to have all this very short and the time was pretty tense. So I hope you could, well, learn a little from that, and thanks for being here.